Well, first, it's just some general stuff. One thing I have to mention at some point is input-output. So it's very primitive for now, so normally everything goes to the terminal. And there are just two mechanisms to access files on the computer, and that's the command less than rmn, usually .at, and this simply reads commands from the file name, the file, then in the command until either the file ends or an error occurs. And so there's the usual way in which this is used. I've opened here one of the files that is .at in the scripts directory, and at the very top it says read basic.at and read matrix.at. Those are two files that are for what's been defined in this file assumed. So it uses commands that are defined elsewhere, so it needs those files, and this is normally what you do. So you use these commands at the very top of any script you define, and principle, every function you need that comes from elsewhere, you need to include the script. It's a very simple mechanism. It simply starts reading commands from the file as if the contents of the file was at the terminal. There's just one slightly intelligent thing, is that you can imagine everybody, for instance, needs basic.at. So if you read in five scripts, you would be reading in basic.at five times. So it doesn't do that. If it already completely read a file successfully, it records that the file is read, and it will not read it again if some other occurrence asks for the same file. If you
So Mark, can you show how that manifests itself when you actually go to the file?
Yeah, so I'm going to session. So now I'm in Atlas, and since I let me just show you what I just did here. I checked that my install has worked. So in my bin directory, that's home bin for me, there is file Atlas, which has two lines, which are here. The first one saying that it's a shell script, and the second one says that it should execute the Atlas program with an explicit path name. So you should check that you have such a file. And of course, the unit should have a different path name. And then it gives you the path for the scripts. That's the important thing, because that's where it will be looking when you include the file. Normally, you don't give a full path name here, but you assume that it comes from a standard location, which in all cases will be this Atlas script directory. And so it adds this as an argument with a hash path so that the system will henceforth know about that. And then it adds all.at, which means that at startup it already includes, as if I had done less than all.at on the first line, it includes this file. And since the file all.at includes loads of other files, that means that basically all scripts are seen. And the last argument means that if on the command line you happen to type yet another name, it will be added to this line. So if you have a new file that's not called by all, if you want to load it at startup, you just say Atlas with a new file. So you can do things on the command line. Here I didn't do anything on the command line. This is the preferred way to start Atlas, not .atlas for all things, just Atlas, which should run this script and Well, if it doesn't, then something has to be changed with your path or what it normally should. So now, for instance, if I say all, it just doesn't do anything because it's already done. But I could load something.
Yeah, so just pause there. So I often use this if I can't remember if I've loaded a file. You just do less than, and if it doesn't do anything, it means you already loaded it.
Yeah. All right. So now I can do something that's not loaded by all. Then yes, I know that there is enter X. That's one. That's not loaded by all, and you see the output comes across. So the reason you get this output is because most of these scripts only contain set commands. So I'll go back here. As you see, apart from this include, it's almost always set some function name with arguments. And what happens if you do a set command is it reports what identifiers have been declared with what types. And that means that on the output, when you load the script, you usually get this kind of output. This particular file is a bit special. It declares identifiers, so it gives them types but not values. But if you load something more regular,
execute the same command again.
Yeah, if I do the same command again, nothing happens. And if you're busy editing the script, sometimes you change the script and you want to load it the second time. You can force that, but doing the second less than. And as you see, it now reloaded the file. Okay. You get the same output, but if I do that with all, it won't load very much actually, because all doesn't. Okay. Everything that all does is included in other files, so reloading all doesn't do much because it's not recursive. I reload it all, but all the other scripts. There's no difference. I think it's smart enough to know that this is the same.
So you don't need the .18 extension
ever. Yeah, but there's. I don't try to this here. This one has AX instead. And then you can see, so it wasn't loaded by all either. And so it defined a couple of things, and just for fun, I'll reload it a second time. And so here it says define, sometimes variable. So it defines functions or variables. Sometimes it says add a definition. If it's an overload of an existing function, it says number of which the change it is. And if I reloading problems is really fun. This means it defines a function, but it already knew that function, so it overrides the definition in the definition. Okay. So that was just one file I knew happened.
So, Mark, to clarify, the global variable length is only if you have modified.
That's only necessary if you have modified a script which previously loaded successfully. If the script never loaded successfully, it knows that it should start reading it again until it loads successfully. Okay, so that's input redirection. Output redirection is even simpler. It's bigger than and on a file name. And then subcommand could be, for example, a set command. I think it has to be an expression.
Three square.
Oh, okay. So now I need to go to here and see if the file will not. Actually, it even contains the prompt value that is normal.
Where do you go to find the library?
Well, since I started my program in AtlasScript, it will now have written file at AtlasScript. So I chose a file name that didn't override an existing file. Because it doesn't check.
Did you have to get out of Atlas to find the file?
Yes, you can of course try to read it again, but that will not be very happy. Oh, that's interesting.
No, prepared for values begins.
Yeah, okay, yeah, but that's kind of
sick. But then you cannot read what you want.
No, if you want to look at the file, you just open it in an editor.
No, reading back in the file that you just wrote is
simply easy. Okay, with an editor, okay.
So I switched from one to one.
It's output, it's something you want to read, it's not. Yeah, it's nothing you're going to.
The idea is if you have huge computation and you don't want to cut and paste from the terminal, then you select the file before you give the command that does the computation. And all the output from the computation will go.
So Mark, I hesitate to ask you this, but we're going to ask anyway. Several people have asked me, why did you choose the syntax where you put the file name first?
First.
The output file comes first before the command.
Oh, that's a very simple reason, because otherwise I'd have to turn the parser input out, inside out to recognize that it's actually doing redirection. I mean, suppose I say that, and then I say, what bigger than x? What does it mean? Well, it's just a boomerang. It would be false. So only way the parser can recognize it is that it cut. It's a less than or mark.
That's the very first pair.
Very, very, I think it skips spaces, but that's about it.
That's a good answer.
So that's why it can.
Good.
Okay. That was in the output. So I made another slide there. I tried to get the whole semantic part of the language on one slide. I didn't succeed, but it's two slides. So it's just to say it's not a very difficult language, I think. It has relatively few elements, all of which are associated with certain kinds of data types. So function application we've already seen, of course, an identifier followed by parentheses is function application, which can take the alternative form here, XLF, is just exactly the same stuff. This can be handy for two reasons. One is if you want to chain functions, they get from left to right. And so if you want G of F of X, it's more natural to write X point F point G, the new order in which it will be applied. And the other is that it doesn't need parentheses. So it's particularly handy if there's just one argument. If there's two arguments to a function, you have the parentheses. But this is something new tackled which wasn't there some time ago. And I find it even sometimes useless. But anyway, it's semantically it's the same as is operator. So if you see an A operator B, then this will be turned into operator A comma B. So operators are not special. And one of the consequences of this rewriting is that all operators can also be used in a monadic fashion, written to the left of their argument. Some operators have unusual definitions, which is, for instance, just applied to one argument. For instance, I have equality testing. 90% of the time, you're testing against zero. So why not make the monadic test equals 5 is false, equals 0 is true. So equals applied to a single integer, not a pair. We'll just test against 0.
What if you say equals SL2R?
Then it will not match. because people don't have, because the single real form doesn't recognize. So, if there are some trivials now. Testing against zero is fairly often used, and it's slightly more efficient if you don't have to evaluate zero. Okay, so that's how you use functions. Of course, if they're built in or defined, that's fine. If you want to define a function, then you need the second line, function abstraction. So that it's a bit abstract as there. But this is the idea, for instance, the predicate of being prime relative to 30. That was so that follows the pattern. You have type, you have pattern. So a pattern could be a single identifier, and then you have an expression after a column. There is a column. Yeah, a column. So that's part of the function syntax. So this is an anonymous function. Can be handy. Very often you have a named function introduced by let, or even more usually by set. And then there is one of these sugar things that he writes. So if you say set successor of int n equals n, there's one, let's make it a true successor. So that's the way you would define this function, very simple. This is actually sugar for equivalent to set successor. That's just the same.
We have a function with local lines.
With?
Local lines.
Yeah, so that's a different question is, well, what happens if the definition takes more lines? Well, then you have to know about the command prolongation. Let me just go to so here you have some examples of definitions. So why does this definition of set module basis span two lines? Well, the first line ends with a colon. And a colon is never the end of the command. So for certain characters, notably colon, semicolon, and operating symbols, it knows that they are never occur at the end of the line. So if that's the last symbol on the line, it automatically goes to the next. And then the next line does not end on anything special. Also, everything that's open in this line, there is a let syntax, which waits for an in, but in is on the same line. There's also a for, but it's closed by odd. And so everything that's open is closed, and there's no reason why it shouldn't end there. And if it's the end of the line, and there is no reason why it can't be the end of the command, it is the end of the command. Sometimes you need to be careful about that. So for instance here, I think this one has a parenthesis here, especially because I think the second line would be complete because it doesn't end in the semicolon. If there wasn't an opening parenthesis, that still needs to be closed.
You could just put the semicolon on the previous line, right? The next character is a semicolon.
Yeah, if I had put the semicolon on the end of the previous line, I wouldn't have needed parentheses. And in fact, that's what happens most of the time. So there's different. Actually, if you do this on the command line, it's interesting. So let me see. Let me define my successor function. Equals. Equals is an operator, so it knows that it's not complete. And now I can n plus, and it's still not complete, and then one, and it's complete. And you see that the prompt, unfortunately, is not on the screen. The prompt is slightly modified, but in addition, you cannot do binary logic. Anyway, you can see that there's this equals and plus. That's an indication of what it's waiting for. It's a kind of abbreviated function, but if I say parenthesis, for instance, then it will have a parenthesis. If I do a square bracket opening, it has a parenthesis and a square bracket opening, saying that both need to be closed. If I do it in the wrong order, I get a syntax error. Like that. And so if I do for then it says G, which means there is a group open. It doesn't say what kind of group, but it knows it's a for if you try to do the wrong closing operation or then or so.
By the way, you always compile your software with debugging enabled because you're always fixing things. But if it's compiled with optimization, then these things you're saying about the little extra prompts are not true.
For some users of Macintosh.
I think Linux. I think I tried this on Linux also. No. You disagree?
I disagree.
Well, I will find out.
I do sometimes use an optimizer. That makes sense. There's absolutely nothing special about the way these things are. I don't see why that would happen, but I've seen it happen. So. Well, it's true, but it's something strange.
No, it's so the Linux systems at MIT, the little extra prompts don't appear with optimized compilation.
Okay. So if you put a parenthesis on your on the collection of commands, then it will recognize you and you execute all of them together.
No, if you put parentheses around your whole file, you do want the commands to get executed now and again. Set is a command and it has to get executed, otherwise nothing happens. But actually, I cannot even do this.
If you have an assumption that you can just put all the constants of the function.
You could make the body of the function in parentheses, or you could put it in begin and if you like that style. Begin ends are also keywords that basically just group. They don't do anything else than group, just like parentheses, but okay, so that's a command propagation. So yeah, I think I've explained the rules. It's either a closed group or the last symbol which cannot be the end of the command.
So how do you have multiple inputs into the function? How do you specify
your
return to it?
Okay, so that's the other sugar. So multiple inputs and outputs is basically using tuple types. So you've got for any combination of types, you can combine them in a Cartesian product. So for instance, you have type int and then type vec. So that's another type, which is a Cartesian product of an integer and a vector, so it has two components, an integer and a vector. And a function that has an integer and a vector parameter actually has a single parameter, which is a tuple. That's the way things are done. And on the same token, if it wants to return multiple values, it just returns a tuple with the component that you want. And instead of saying according to normal syntax, something like this, so let's call it N and V, because that's the pattern part of the slide. So after the type, there's pattern. So if the type is a tuple type, then you can have a matching pattern. So this would be the normal way to make the most standard way would be to do this and then make some expression of that. So that would be the normal way to define the maybe not the most common way, but the most standardized way is set f equals and then an anonymous function which takes an int vec argument, which it decomposes with 10 to the V, and then it does an expression with N to V. But, N times V, it's not by the vector atmosphere. So that's, but if this is equivalent to another form, so that's sugar, and then, since I also not didn't write the equals there, I'll write it there. That's the same trick here. The equals officially should come directly after the name, but it's somewhat more pleasant to think of it as a successor of the n equals n plus 1, so that's allowed. And same here, f of an n integer n in vector v is that expression. Okay, I'll just add, suppose this is a vector value multiplied by a scalar, so after this it will say, so, okay, maybe this is not, you get maybe a different type because I think I've changed the definition of scalar multiplication here, because I would have expected vec as target window. Anyway, it deduced that was the type because it knows about multiplication, and so I didn't have to state the type of the result of the function. Well, I had to state the type of the arguments of the function. So that's a general rule. But for readability, it is often recommended to state the type. And how do I do this? I do this, say I want a function that actually really returns a vector, so it will make a conversion. And then I say vec colon here after the equal sign. So this is the most usual syntax. So after the equal sign, the result type at colon, but that's actually just a case where the expression is a cast to this type. And in this case, it will give that type. And so even though my built-in multiplication was somehow giving me a list of integers, I forced it to a vector type. Of course, I couldn't have forced it to string, it would obviously not work, but this works. And so in this case, if you see this definition in the file, it's obvious that the result type is vec, and that's, if you're reading code, is vital, because if you use the result of this function as an argument to another one, then you have to know what kind of argument is passed to even know how the overload will be resolved. And so it's for readability, it's very highly recommended to make the result type evident in function.
Let me make a comment here. So I've written a lot of these scripts, and one dirty little trick that I often use is I write a function and I don't specify the return type because it might be complicated. It might be a three tuple of an integer, vector, and adjective or something. And then I say what, after I've gotten it working, I say what type, and it tells me, and then I go in and put that in explicitly. As a return type, so it's stated in the file.
Well, it's also stated while you're loading the file. While you're loading the file, it will tell you what result type is, so you can just see it.
Often I don't need to think about it beforehand. The computer will tell me what it's returning, and then I just put that in.
So it's definitely convenient that you don't have to say it. But,
So these functions, you're also defining while you're running a session.
Anything you can do in the file, you can do in the session, and vice versa. So if you just want to run a load of commands, not define nothing, just have some commands that take hours to run, and you put them in a file, then you can load the file, and you can start executing these commands, and it will take hours for the file to compute, but that's how it is.
But as soon as you quit, they're gone, right? You just put them in the session.
Yes.
Yeah, your session, if you say quit, your session is gone. And there's no global command to save everything in a session.
When I look at the type of multiplying an integer by a vector built in, it says that it's producing a vector.
Yeah, so I've been playing around with basic.at, so that's what's going on.
Okay.
My local basic.at is not the one doing that.
Sorry for that. So the problem was the July 12th.
Yeah,
you're getting your
second. You're 24 hours late.
So what's the return? Is it always the output of the last command block? If it has.
Yeah, the return type is the type of the expression that follows. And the expression can be complicated.
If you have several commands.
If you have several commands, then usually it's the final command that you learn to type.
It explicitly states what you want to return. Is there a...
Yeah, that's what I say. The usual way to do it is immediately after the equal sign you will pass. The syntax is so that if the expression could be parsed at least, it will also be correctly parsed. I mean, there's no additional bracketing necessary. Just write the return type and column, and that will ensure that the same expression is evaluated, and then, if necessary, it will be converted to that type.
So perhaps the question is, if you write a subroutine or something, in C++, it can do a bunch of things, it can compute, but the definition of a function in Atlas is required to be a single expression.
It is a single expression.
It can't be...
That's the basic idea. Everything is an expression. Even if you don't actually want to return a value, you could say void. So I could, if I would have been silly, I could say void here, and it evaluates the expression and throws away the result. And now you see that the result type has nothing after the end.
What I'm asking is, ask if you have
what's
the question?
If you've got an if statement, and if something does not satisfy the condition I want the program just to stop there, you have this return keyword where you can just stop there. Is there anything similar?
Let's say you say this: if then less than zero, then error. Is this a kind of scenario you're thinking of? So actually, error is a somewhat special case. You recognize that it will never return, and it just in this case it's the else case that will return the type. And so it will work. But if I actually call this with a negative argument like that. So now it says hold, and then it gives a trace back to how it is.
Instead of every time return the value, return something instead of giving the error.